All right. I have edited the first half, and it will be uploaded soon. So I'm ready to talk about the top 10 movies and television shows that I saw for the first time, asterisk, this year. If you watched the previous video, you know that I have included things that I have seen before if it had been a long time, like 10 or more years, to the point where I didn't remember it very well. And there is one thing on this top 10 that qualifies, fits that bill. I spent a lot of time and effort putting this list together in the last 2 weeks, watching a ton of stuff, and trying to catch up as much as I could so that I could cram as many things in before the end of the year. I initially wanted to have it so that everything on the list would be a 5-star thing, and I did get that plus some. It did make it so that there were a lot of things that got kind of bumped off the list that were 4.5-star movies, including a number of quite good films that came out this year that I saw that you may be asking, you know, where are they on this list? So things that had, I gave 4.5 stars that came out this year that I really enjoyed, but just not as much as these. Lamb, that was a wonderful. Paul Schrader's recent The Card Counter, starring Oscar Isaac. Last Night in Soho, the new Edgar Wright movie, as well as Edgar Wright's documentary, The Sparks Brothers, about the band Sparks. The Velvet Underground documentary that came out on Apple TV+. Those are all 4.5-star, highly recommended, good recent this year movies. There were other movies that I saw that I gave less than that, but we don't need to talk about them. What? Dune? Dune Your Mom? Is that? 4 out of 5. and there are definitely things from this year that I have not seen yet, that I have missed as much as I tried. Drive My Car, the Murakami adaptation. Haven't gotten around to watching that yet. It is 3 hours long, which is part of why I haven't watched it yet, because I always procrastinate watching long things. There are also, of course, plenty of things that came out that I'm not interested in and didn't see that are getting award season buzz or whatever, I guess. So something like Kenneth Branagh's Belfast, I could not care less, or the Spielberg West Side Story, don't care. But I think I did a pretty good job of staying caught up on stuff. There are TV, too, that I really need to watch Succession. I haven't watched any of Succession yet. It's, people really are very intense about how good Succession is, so I do want to watch it. There are a number of other things, too, that are happening that I've missed, but that's okay. Let's talk about the top 10. So we've got 10 things on the list. One of the entries is a film series, a tetralogy of films, and two things on the list are television. One of them, the other thing I'll say is that I really was pulling my hair out about ranking. I've made my feelings about ranking stuff and picking things over other things known. I don't like doing it. I don't feel good about coming out and saying, I like this thing more than this other thing. It makes it feel like the thing that you're putting under is, like, lesser than, or less important, or not as good, or something. It just feels bad. I don't like doing that. And so I thought about, like, how could I do this without ranking things? I was able to do it up to a point. Once it got up towards, like, 5 to 1, started getting harder. But I was like, I have to talk about them one at a time. So there's going to be an order no matter what. And, you know, I'm just going to do it. I'm not going to think about it too much. I am going to probably emphasize quite a bit once I get to that point how little the ranking truly matters. And the thing that ultimately edged out me putting what number one is at number one is that it came out this year. And the thing that was at number two didn't. And I couldn't really decide which one I wanted to be number one. And that was how I chose. So it was very arbitrary. But that's enough preamble. Let's actually do the list. Starting out at number 10, we have season 2. This isn't finished airing yet. There's still, I believe, one episode left. It's coming out this week. But I'm still confident enough to put it at number 10 on this list. Season 2 of HBO's How To with John Wilson.
Hey, New York. There's a lot of stuff that happened since the last season of the show ended. You had to spend a whole lot of time inside and got really close with just a handful of people. You got really good at cutting your own hair and discovered exciting new ways to entertain yourself. But you still found a way to show up for work every day and treated yourself to a vacation whenever it felt safe. And just when you thought that things were going back to normal, the nightmare just seemed to continue. A lot of people thought that we wouldn't be able to make another season of the show, but we did. And it still has all your favorite stuff from the first one. New York looks more interesting right now than it ever has before. And even though you lost a lot of what you loved, it really made you appreciate what you still have. So don't be upset if you feel like you missed anything along the way, because you don't always realize you're in the middle of history until it's over. John Wilson, talk to you soon.
John Wilson is a videographer, documentarian, humorous person. And his show reminds me a lot of the sense of humor of Nathan Fielder, which makes a lot of sense, because Nathan Fielder kind of discovered John Wilson and got him this show as an executive producer. So there's Nathan Fielder's got his finger in the pie here, so to speak. But the thing that John Wilson does that Nathan Fielder doesn't as much is there is such an incredible amount of weight and gravitas and to his work. Every episode of the show is about a simple concept, a simple idea, and how to do that thing. But the way that he explores the ideas that he sets out with is so fascinating. For instance, there's an episode of this new season that's called How to Throw Away Your Old Batteries, or something along those lines. You know, what I live in a place where you can just throw the batteries away in the regular garbage. Like alkaline, regular, you know. These guys. You can just throw them in the garbage. but not so in New York. And so you accumulate these dead batteries, and they just sit, you know, under your sink, and what do you do with them? But then what ends up happening is we start, you know, we go to recycling centers, we see how things are recycled. Then we start thinking about, you know, what does throwing things away mean? How do we dispose of the things in life that we don't want anymore? And one of the avenues that he takes is he ends up in this neighborhood where all of the sex offenders live because of the way that, like, sex offender residence law is. You have to be a certain distance away from public parks and public schools, etc., etc. And so it made it so that there are very few places that sex offenders are able to live once they're released. And so they create these sort of weird ghettos of, you know, low-income housing that is predominantly sex offenders. And the show stops being about, you know, how do I throw away batteries? And it starts being like, what do we do when we want to throw away people? And what are the consequences when we as a society decide that this group of people should be thrown away? Pretty heavy for a comedy show. The other thing I really love about John Wilson's style is how he tells jokes. The way he tells jokes, because the whole show is it's shot by him, first person, just with walking on the street with a camera, and then he narrates over the top of the show. And the way that he tells jokes is he will be narrating, and he will say something that's not a joke, but then the image that he chooses to accompany the words that he is speaking makes a joke. It's very interesting. I've never seen anything quite like it, and it's very funny. Since he's out doing, like, street photography, basically, in New York, he's talking to lots of, you know, weird and interesting people. The thing I really love the most about John Wilson is that he is never condescending. He never is implying that you should be laughing at someone. He never mocks. He never feels mean-spirited. He always is just about understanding people and celebrating the things that makes them unique. Like, there's a part in the most recent episode that aired where there's a sort of digression that happens. He winds up in a comic book store, and he meets this guy who is looking through comics about Avatar, the James Cameron film. And they start talking about it, and he finds out that this guy is part of this fan society of people who are very into Avatar, and that they're having a little sort of get-together, and so that John Wilson gets invited, and so he goes, he brings his camera to this meeting of half a dozen people who are all very deeply obsessed with Avatar, which feels like an opportunity to mock, right? It's such a silly thing, you know, this to be this obsessed with Avatar. But the way that these people talk about Avatar, where one person who is talking about their, you know, experiences and hardships with disability and chronic pain and things like that, and how the idea of how, like, Jake, the main character from Avatar, he's disabled, he's in a wheelchair, but he's able to put his mind into the Avatar creature, and he regains, you know, his mobility, and She's like, some disability rights activists think that the movie is ableist because of that, but I say bullshit. Like, anybody who's disabled, anybody who has lived with that would give anything to be able to just be able, you know, like to lose that disability. And finds it a very sort of spiritual, hopeful fantasy. And who am I to say that they're wrong, you know? And there's another part where they're talking about what they call, like, post-Avatar depression, where they, you know, their lives are so miserable, and when they watch Avatar, it's this fantastical escape for them. They're able to kind of leave the real world behind and go inhabit the, you know, fantastical world of Pandora and all of these things. But then when they are done, when they finish the film and they have to come back to reality, they enter this, like, deep depressive period of like a few days where it just, it feels like overwhelming that the world is the way it is. And Avatar doesn't make me feel that way, but there are definitely things that do. And then when they start all talking to each other in the Na'vi language, there's something so sweet about it, even though it is funny, even though it's silly and goofy. I don't think that there has ever been a comedy television show that is as heartfelt and poignant and intelligent as, I think, as How To with John Wilson. It's airing on HBO right now. I believe tomorrow the new episode comes out. It's probably already out by the time I have this up. I believe that's the last episode of the season. There's two seasons out. So if you have HBO Max, you can watch it. And I highly recommend that you do. It's really incredible. Number 9, we have another television show. It is an anime show that ran for 13 half-hour episodes in 1998, and it is called Serial Experiments Lain.
Hello, Navi.
Hello, Lain.
It was suicide. She jumped off a building last week. The teacher told everyone.
But if she's dead, then we shouldn't be getting any email from her.
Hello? How are you? I have only given up my body. You see, by sending you email, I can use the system to explain to you that I am still alive.
Let's all love Lain.
You know, Lain, in the real world, people are connected somehow. That's how societies are created. You can live and communicate in both worlds. There's nothing to be afraid of.
I'm not scared. Not really.
We were partying, Lain, out at Siberia last night, where we saw a girl who looked exactly like you.
But last night, I was...
Who in the hell are you?
I am me. I'm the only me, right? And there isn't any other me but me.
Just an advanced medium for communication. Don't ever get it confused with the real world.
You're wrong. The border between the two isn't so clear.
You don't have to remain a wretched human being forever. Mankind has finally created an exit.
I've known about Lain for a very long time. It's a much beloved cult classic of anime. I've owned a physical copy of the show. I bought it when I first started at Half Price Books, which was over 5 years ago. But I didn't actually sit down and watch it until like a month ago. even though it's short, it's 13, you know, 22-minute episodes. It concerns the story of a young girl, teen girl, Lain. And it takes place in a near future that's not dissimilar from our own. And in this similar future, near future, people are really obsessed with this technology called the Wired. And the Wired is just the internet. But then remember, this is 1998, so the internet was pretty new at the time. The World Wide Web, Web 1.0, went live in 95. So there were, you know, proto-internet things like BBSs and stuff like that that were existing before, but the modern internet as we understand it started in 1995. A lot of people want to say that this show is in some way anticipatory of the real world, that it predicted the way things would become, the way that we're addicted to technology or something like that. I guess, but I feel like doing that is really missing the point of what Lain is about. What this show is about in a bigger picture sense is, like, what makes people people? And it explores this through technology a lot, where what's the difference from a person as a concept and an idea, a concept itself, if what constitutes a person, a personality, is simply a brain, is electrical impulses firing along a neural network of pathways. And if we put ourselves into a computer, which is functionally very similar to a brain, operates off of the passage of electricity along pathways, are we still who we are there? And if we, in that world, can wield the power of what we would conceptualize in the real world of a god, are we then God? Are we God in the machine? If everybody can be godlike, is God relevant? There's a lot happening in this show. The actual what the show plot-wise is about, it starts to get a little loosey-goosey after a bit, but the framing setup, I guess, is that this girl, student, Lain is a teenager, and one of her classmates commits suicide at the outset of the show. She finds out after this girl's death that other people, other students at the school, have been receiving emails from the dead girl after she died. Lain gets interested. Her dad is obsessed with computers, and so she starts investigating, and she gets an email from the dead girl, Chisa, and Chisa says that she's not dead, but she has simply abandoned her physical self to exist solely within the Wired. And she did this because within the Wired she found God. And from that point, we go into all of my favorite bullshit. So you've got secret societies, you've got cryptic clues, you've got conspiracies, you've got the body horror, the destruction of the body, the freeing of the mind. Things start getting really weird and a little hard to follow at a point. I do think I need to definitely watch it again. I think that I probably missed a lot. But the show is wild and so up my alley. It is available on Funimation. Funimation has the licensing for it for North America. So if you have the Funimation app streaming service, you can watch it on there. Or you can pick up a physical copy of it for pretty cheap. I think the Blu-ray is like $20. Yeah. Also, Duvet, the theme to this show, best anime opening song of all time. Better than Cruel Angel's Thesis. Better song than Cruel Angel's Thesis. I said what I said. Number 8 is one of two things in the top 10 here that I have technically seen before, but I had not seen this movie since probably 2003 or 4. And I only saw it once. So I was like 13 when I saw it, and I remembered very little about it. And I knew for a while that I needed to rewatch it, because I had this deep feeling where I was like, I'm gonna love this movie. I didn't really get it, I think, the first time I saw it when I was a kid, but I'm gonna love this movie if I watch it again. And it just so happened that it's a Christmas film. And so the Alamo Drafthouse did a screening of it on Christmas Eve, just a week ago. And me and two of my buds trekked out to Woodbury. It's like a 35-minute drive from where I live to this movie theater. It's on the complete opposite end of the metro area. To see the final film by Stanley Kubrick, 1998's Eyes Wide Shut. So, Eyes Wide Shut, pretty well-known movie. Like most Kubrick movies, not well-liked upon release. Didn't have any sort of acclaim, really, or it had mixed reviews. Didn't really get nominated for any awards. Kubrick died, before it came out. It also seemingly precipitated the dissolution of the marriage of the two stars of the film, Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman, who had been in a relationship for like 10 years at the time that the movie was made. The thing that everybody knows Eyes Wide Shut for is the freaky sex party. I don't think it's much of a spoiler to say that there is a point in this movie where Tom Cruise goes to this mansion where there are a bunch of masked people having freaky sex orgies and with each other. So, again, this movie has so many tropes and things that I like. It's got secret societies, it's got the sort of, descent, the normal man descending into the underworld kind of storyline. It's got the compelling mystery that's like a thread that's pulling you through the whole thing, the feverish obsession with figuring things out. It's got weird sex, which is a big thing for me. Big fan of weird and horny in tandem with each other. The other thing I really like about this movie, not that it necessarily, vibe with it or feel this way, but it's like a cuck movie. It's like a weird beta cuck movie. And in the sense where the inciting incident basically is that, like, Tom Cruise feels like he's very confident in the strength of his marriage, and he doesn't have anything to worry about. And then he finds out that his wife had contemplated having an affair with another man. She didn't, but she thought about it. And it just completely emasculates and destroys Tom Cruise's character's everything. And then he goes out into the night just, like, trying to, I don't even know, reclaim some amount of masculine power over his own life. And it's so weird. It feels like the whole movie is hinged upon the fact that Tom Cruise is the lead in it, and that he's the most famous guy. You know, is 98, so it's like this. He's the sexiest, most famous, biggest actor, A-list celebrity in the world. The man's man, sexiest man alive, all of that. And the whole movie is like, it's designed to emasculate him and make him look like a fucking pussy. Like a little bitch. I have no idea why he agreed to be in this movie, because knowing what I know about him, it seems like the kind of thing that he would never allow to happen. I imagine it must have been the allure of the prestige of working with Kubrick. Ego something? The other reason why Tom Cruise is really great and perfect in the role is that, you know, when you see interviews with Tom Cruise and you watch enough footage of Tom Cruise, you know, not literally in the movie, I at least feel like he's just always acting. Like, there is no real Tom Cruise. You know, like, you dig an inch under the surface, there's just hollow air. There's nothing under there. He's just always performing. And he's like a husk. And that is, like, perfect for this role, because that's kind of what his character is doing, too. His character is always extremely confident, but, like, shouldn't be, and, like, seems to have it together, but really doesn't, and, like, I don't know, it's really fascinating. I like Kubrick a lot. You know, I have a huge amount of respect for him. The thing that, as I have aged, that has pushed his films further from, you know, the center of my heart is the sort of, like, cold, detached emotionlessness of his work. And I'm not the only one that feels that way. He's a guy who really likes ideas more than feelings. And I like both. Usually I want both. Eyes Wide Shut, I think, is my favorite of his films, though, because it's the one film where he takes the sort of cold and emotionless nature of his style and really harnesses it to amplify the themes of the movie that he is exploring. That in tandem with it being things that I'm, like, kind of a sucker for, like secret societies and conspiracies and rabbit holes and things like that. So yeah, I fucking love this movie. This is a Christmas tradition from now on. Die Hard is a Christmas movie, and I don't have a problem with watching Die Hard on Christmas, but if it's going to be up to me to pick the Christmas movie, Die Hard's not number one. Not even close. This one's going to be number one. Number two is obviously Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Number seven. I made reference to this in the first half of the video, where this had drifted down pretty low on the list, and then I rewatched it and I moved it up from like 18 to 7. And a lot of the things I mentioned that I liked about Eyes Wide Shut, I also really like about this movie. It was released in 2018, it's directed by David Robert Mitchell, the director of It Follows, and it is called Under the Silver Lake, starring Andrew Garfield. You ask me if that'll happen.
I saw you spying on me earlier.
No, I wasn't.
Okay.
See you tomorrow.
Good.
Who moves out in the middle of the night?
Nothing strange about it. She wanted to leave. How does that not make sense?
I don't understand why she didn't tell me.
Maybe she didn't like you. Maybe she knows you're poor and haven't paid your rent.
I found some kind of code or like secret message in her apartment.
It means stay quiet. Our world is filled with codes, subliminal messages. From Silver Lake to the Hollywood Hills.
Could any of this be connected to Sarah?
I know this girl.
There's a message in the music.
Really think you're gonna find a hidden message in a pop song?
1, 2, 3.
Can't quite see it, but I'm close.
Honey, how are you?
Mom, I'm fine. Mostly fine.
Why do we assume that all of this information is what we're told it is? Maybe there are people out there who are more important than us, more powerful, communicating things in the world that are meant for only them and not for us.
Yeah.
Oh, you think that's weird?
A little. Welcome to Purgatory.
Good to be here.
You're living in a carnival. Hoping to win a prize. What are you gonna win?
Get down! Under the Silver Lake.
So, the plot here, Andrew Garfield is this 30-something loser, slacker, musician type. He's basically Scott Pilgrim, if Scott Pilgrim wasn't funny. And he lives in Los Angeles, and he meets this girl, his neighbor, who lives in the same apartment complex as him. And they spend the night together, they form a mild bond, I suppose. And then the next morning, she's disappeared. And he doesn't know, he wants to find out what happened to her, where she went. And this is the beginning of a rabbit hole that he falls into and starts uncovering conspiracies and secret societies and ciphers and hidden messages hidden within pop culture. And it's a great sort of like noir madcap Los Angeles movie. And it's really weird and goofy, but also very fun and has this really good sort of message where it's what it is at its core is like probably the best takedown of the nice guy white knight trope in men that I've ever seen. Much more so than Promising Young Woman, which I had in my honorable mentions, and is good, but is not subtle. This movie is subtle. I walk away from this movie feeling like Andrew Garfield's character is like the villain in this movie. You know, we come to see him as like obsessive and controlling and, you know, he cares way too much about figuring out what happened to this girl that he barely knows and allows himself to, you know, let all the other parts of his life fall apart because he doesn't want to deal with them because this is more interesting and more fun or whatever. And he's not really nice. He's not really a good person. He doesn't really care. I don't know. It's a really fascinating movie that I feel like I could watch a bajillion times and figure out something new every time. It also is actually filled with secret messages that there's a subreddit dedicated to trying to crack all of these codes and hidden messages that are in the movie, which was pretty cool. Yeah, this one, unfortunately, it was on Prime Video for a long time, but it's no longer, so your only choice is to pick up a physical or rent it on VOD. But, very, very good. It is long, I will say. Some people really didn't like that about it. It's like 2.5 hours long. Didn't bother me at all. It doesn't bother me one bit that it's long. I think it really earns its runtime, so there you go. Number 6, we have a film, Japanese film. Now I'm going to say up front, because I'm showing you trailers and stuff, this movie has never officially been released in English. There's never been a English, American, whatever, release of the movie on DVD or Blu-ray. It's not available to stream or rent digitally anywhere in English. The only way to watch it is to pirate it with, like, I'm assuming fan-made English subtitles. And part of the downside of that is that the only trailers that exist on the internet for it don't have subtitles. So, I apologize as I present to you the trailer for Hideaki Anno's Ritual from the year 2000 with no subtitles. Bear with me.
明日は私の誕生日なの。明日は私の誕生日。明日は私の誕生日だ。明日は私の誕生日。誰でもいいのかもしれない。ただいつも変わることのない愛を与え続けてくれる人がいれば。
Okay, so that gives you a little bit of an idea, maybe, of the kind of vibe ish things that's going on here. So this is a love story, romance story. Yeah. So Hideaki Anno, if you don't know, came to fame as an animator. He worked for Studio Ghibli doing animation, most notably for Hayao Miyazaki's Nausicaä and the Valley of the Wind, before he branched out with a number of other people, founded an animation studio called Gainax. He was then hired on to direct a anime series that was very successful called Nadia. And then after the success of Nadia, he was basically given carte blanche to make a project and do whatever he wanted. And he did, and the result of that was an anime that would go on to be the most popular and famous adult anime ever made, which is Neon Genesis Evangelion, which originally aired in 1995 and 96, and then was followed up by a film called The End of Evangelion in 1997. I'm not going to talk too much about Evangelion here, but I will say that the process of making Evangelion, which was a show about trauma and depression, that Anno put a lot of himself into, was very hard for him, and he did not have a good time doing it. And by all accounts, it seems like after it was over, he was not in a very great place for a while. And it would read to me like the way he kind of came through to the other side of that was by making this film, Ritual, or Shikijitsu, as its original title is. So the story of Shikijitsu, or Ritual, is this man in his 30s who is a director. He leaves Tokyo and comes back to his hometown, which is the city of Ube. And while he is there, he is walking on the train tracks, he meets a young woman who is sitting on the train tracks, and he develops an interest in her and starts palling around with her, basically. Now, the woman is very odd. She dresses very eccentrically, and she is obsessed with rituals. Daily rituals that she will repeat, the most prominent of which is that every day she says that tomorrow is her birthday, but her birthday never actually comes. She seems afraid of reality and constantly needs to sort of regress into a world of fantasy. Another one of her rituals is every morning she goes up onto the roof of the building that she lives in and hangs off the side of it to basically decide if she wants to live anymore, if she wants to keep living. So this director, who's unnamed, his name is Director, he's... if I remember right, there's a little line where he mentions how he doesn't want to work in animation anymore. Very clearly an author surrogate for Anno. He decides that he's going to make a movie about this woman. And so he starts filming her as they spend time together. And the movie takes place over the course of just over a month. With every day, there's a title card saying which day it is and then how many days until something is going to happen. But it doesn't tell you what. This movie came at a time I really needed it, you know? I'm a big fan of Anno. Big fan of Anno. And, this is definitive proof that he is not to be defined by Evangelion. He is more than that. The thing about this movie that really fucked me up, but also the linchpin of why I think I loved it so much, is that it's about a guy who just desperately wants to save this woman that he loves. And even though this is not even remotely, literally, what my marriage was like, in so many ways, it really feels the same. But I got divorced, and, you know, kind of destroyed myself trying to save someone else. And in this movie, that's not what happens. And I find a lot of solace in that. Also, fun fact, the director, played by Anno's friend Shinji Iwai, who is an actual film director and not an actor. He's best known for directing the film All About Lily Choo Choo, which I have not seen all of. I started it, but I didn't finish it. And this is actually, the movie is based on a novella by Ayako Fujitani. And Ayako Fujitani plays the woman in the film. And she is Steven Seagal's daughter. Because Steven Seagal, before he was famous, lived in Japan and was married to a Japanese woman. So there you go. Hideaki Anno casts his friend to play himself in a film where he falls in love with mentally ill female Pee-wee Herman, as played by Steven Seagal's daughter. And if that doesn't sell this movie to you, I don't know what will. We're in the top five. We're at the point where things are getting really spicy. Next at five is a movie that I have seen before, but again, I saw it one time when I was young, and I remembered very little of it. It did leave a pretty good impression on me when I saw it the first time, but I think I was just so young that I didn't really understand what it was about it that appealed to me. And that is the movie Crash. Hang on. Not the Academy Award-winning Paul Haggis film from 2004. Because that movie is very bad. Instead, we are talking about the 1996 film Crash, directed by David Cronenberg.
The car crash is a liberation of sexual energy rather than a destructive event. It's something we are all intimately involved in. The reshaping of the human body by modern technology.
Are you badly hurt? Describe it to me.
You coming?
So, Crash is known as a movie about people who want to fuck cars. If you want to be kind of reductive about it, it's based on a novel by J.G. Ballard, who is, you know, one of the kings of transgressive literature in the English language. And so it concerns a man named James Ballard, played by James Spader, the guy who now, you know, is best known as that guy your mom really likes because he's on the blacklist. But before that, he was in this, where he, you know, he and his wife have this sort of dispassionate relationship. They are unable to be, you know, as sexually intimate as they wish they could be. And so they have, like, an open marriage, they sleep with other people, and then they tell each other their sexual exploits to try and kind of, I don't know, sexually bond with each other. But what ends up happening is that James Spader's character gets into a very bad car crash with another car that has a couple in it, a husband and a wife, and the husband dies in the crash. And the wife is played by Holly Hunter. And in the wake of the crash, as they're sitting there staring at each other through the windshields, Holly Hunter tries to take her seatbelt off, and she accidentally rips her blouse open and shows him her breast. And that's kind of like the beginning. That's like the spark. And both of them you know, they meet in the hospital, and then they meet again when he goes. They both end up going to try and get their cars from the impound lot at the police station. And then they end up having sex in the back of a car. And then she takes him to this event where all of these car crash enthusiasts are staging a recreation of the crash that killed James Dean for a, you know, bleacher of spectators with stuntmen, you know, driving the cars. And then they meet the man who is hosting this event, named Vaughn, played by Elias Koteas, who is this guy who is this sort of, like, philosopher about crashing, about vehicles, and about, you know, what it is that is so attractive about that. Ultimately, I'm not going to keep just synopsizing the whole movie, because that's dumb. You should just watch it yourself. This is a movie about sort of the intertwining of sex and death, where, you know, sex is the creation of life and death is the end of the, of life. Everybody in this movie is, like, insatiably horny. They just need to compulsively fuck everything and everyone around them. But the thing that they're the horniest for is dying. And it's sort of like, they don't necessarily actually want to die. Maybe they do. But it's almost like they're trying to edge life. You know, they're trying to, like, get as close to dying as possible without coming. It gets to the point where this cycle kind of repeats itself to its logical conclusion, which is that eventually you have to come, right? Eventually you have to die, but when you do die, then you're gonna come, like, real hard. And there's this sort of dichotomy where it's like sex is this thing that, like, you know, for most people traditionally is a very sort of enlivening, makes you feel alive sort of experience, which is, you know, in flies in the face of this whole death thing. But then when you combine them, it's like the totality of humanity and the human experience all mushed into one thing. I don't think this is a movie that's particularly, like, hopeful or happy, or it's very, I think, it's very cynical and dark, and it's a very cynical and dark look at sex and sexuality, and very transgressive in that way. But there is something about, like, the thing I was describing, this horniness for death, edging death, that feels very relatable to me, where, you know, when you live with depression for long enough, as you sort of toe that line of, like, how likely am I to die, you know, at any time? How much effort am I willing to put into continuing? There is an excitement in that experience that, in a bottle isn't necessarily sexual, but I can see how it is analogous. I said before that weird and horny is, like, one of my things. I like that. I like the combination. And it doesn't get much more that than this movie. Yeah. This is a good one to watch with your meemaw. At number 4, we have a film that was released this year. It is starring Nicolas Cage, and it is called Pig.
looking for a truffle pig. Someone stole her.
I don't understand.
Tell him who you are.
You made the right choice, being out there in the woods. There's nothing here for you anymore. There's really nothing here for most of us. Buy yourself a new pig.
What are you thinking?
I remember every meal I ever cooked. I remember every person I ever served. You live your life for them, and they don't even see you. You don't even see yourself. We don't get a lot of things to really care about. Who has my pig?
So Pig, before it came out, a lot of people were talking about it like it was going to be John Wick, but with Nicolas Cage and a pig. And it is so far from that that I can't even begin to tell you how far it is from that. It is similar to that in the sense that there is an animal that something happens to. In this case, the pig gets kidnapped. And that the middle-aged man goes out looking for the people who are responsible. It is similar in that way. It is also similar in that it is a little bit about grief, or that the animal is more of a sort of metaphor for a loved one who is no longer there. But where that is just sort of the set dressing that we have to give us the motivation to incite the action of John Wick, Pig is a incredibly quiet, understated, deeply intense drama, prestige drama film, starring one of the greatest actors of all time. I don't care what you think of Nicolas Cage. He is one of the greatest and most versatile actors ever. And he puts in maybe the best performance he's ever given in this movie. There's a scene in this movie where he goes to a restaurant. We learn early in the movie that he used to be a chef. And the chef, head chef of this restaurant, knows him. And they sit down and they have a conversation at the table. And it's not just Nick Cage. Nick Cage isn't carrying the scene. The other guy is very good too. But this scene is like one of the greatest pieces of acting that I have ever seen. Just hands down, straight up, unbelievable. Ultimately, this is a movie that's about loss and grief and trauma. And, you know, coming out of a period of my life, I didn't have someone die, but, you know, getting divorced is pretty bad. It sucks pretty hard. And it is a type of grief and loss, a loss of a relationship, of a partnership, of a norm and a status quo. You know, your life is completely upended and you have to start living differently and relearning how to do everything. And so in that way, it is very similar to the grief of losing a loved one to death. And so I've really felt this movie pretty hard. when I saw it, it was, like, inconceivable to me that I was going to see something before the year ended that was better than it. Yet here we are with it at number four. Just saying. Let's move on to something that I have too much to say about. At number three, I have taken a tetralogy of films and I have condensed them into one slot on this list. The space that it occupies at number three is representative of where I would have placed the highest ranked one of the four films, but which is the fourth of the four, but the second and third I would have also put in top 10. For sure. I have a separate list that's on Letterboxd, because Letterboxd doesn't have TV shows and stuff, and they are, all three are in the top 10, so. But this tetralogy of films was released between 2007, the first one, and this year, 2021, for the fourth one. And it is a series of films known as The Rebuild of Evangelion, directed by Hideaki Anno, who I was just talking about. So, I don't think it's possible to talk about Rebuild without talking about the original Evangelion, and I need to talk a little bit about the difference and my relationship with them. So, Evangelion, in its original form, was a 26-episode single-season television show that was produced in the mid-90s. And for a variety of reasons, mainly due to the backlash over the sort of controversial and ambiguous ending of the show, Anno and Gainax made a movie called The End of Evangelion, which was sort of a retelling of the finale of the show. And that movie is one of the best movies ever made. That's a top 10 all-time movie for me. Evangelion in its totality, you know, I guess with this as well, but just at the time what I thought of is the totality, the show and the movie. One of my favorite stories that's ever been told. One of only, like, two television shows that's ever, like, truly, truly deeply moved me and has been, like, with me for a long time. The other one, of course, is Twin Peaks. And I first saw Evangelion when I was a kid, when I was a teenager, because they played it on Adult Swim. But it wasn't until I was a later teen, maybe 15 or 16, that I actually watched all of it straight through. And in the years since, I have watched all of it through a dozen maybe more times. And so Evangelion is the story of a future dystopian world where, after a sort of cataclysmic impact of a meteor at the South Pole that killed like half of the world's population, we then have found ourselves as humanity under assault by a series of monsters that are known as angels. And the only thing that we can fight, that can combat these angels with, are a type of living robot known as an Evangelion. And for some reason, Evangelion can only be piloted by 14-year-old children. So when I tell you all of this, it sounds fairly familiar. You know, children in the giant robot is a trope, a big trope. You know, you've got Macross and Gundam, and there's tons of them. This Evangelion uses this, and a lot of other otaku tropes, just as sort of a springboard to be what is ultimately the most philosophical television show ever made. A show that is very deeply about depression and trauma, and about exploring why we do the things that we do, and why we choose to do them, and whether there's a point. And the thing is that Anno, the creator, it's clear that he struggles a lot with these things, and it's clear that he vacillates in his opinion on them, which is true to anybody who I think has really severe depression, like he and I do, the kind of depression that renders you like incapable of working and unable to go outside and withhold your, you know, social contracts and things like that. You know, we're constantly looking for hope and constantly overwhelmed by hopelessness. And so I've found for half my life Evangelion to be a deeply spiritual and moving story that I really see a lot of myself in, and it gives me a lot of comfort, and but also is a very bleak story. And End of Evangelion is tough. You know, it's, like I said, it's so good. The thing, though, I won't spoil anything with specifics, but I will just say that the ending of the show, while ambiguous, felt hopeful. It felt like Shinji, the main character, was going to be okay. And End of Evangelion felt like Anno, you know, taking in all of the hatred that the fandom gave him for the ending, really being deeply affected by it, and then coming back and saying, "You want to know? Well, let me tell you." And then he proceeded to take all hope away. He proceeded to create one of the most devastating things that's ever existed, with an ending that will fuck your world up. And so it was that 10 years after the end of Evangelion, we had the rebuild of Evangelion. This was announced around the time that I was watching Evangelion for the first time. And when it was announced, what it was announced as was that it was going to be 4 films. And the first 3 films were going to basically be redoing the first 24 episodes of the show with a higher budget, new computer animation technology, streamlining stuff, cutting some of the fat, etc., etc. And then the fourth film, we would be presented with a new, different ending to the series. And then shortly after that, the first of the rebuild films was released. Evangelion 1.0, You Are Not Alone, with not in parentheses. And everything I heard about it basically confirmed what they had said. Everyone was like, yeah, it's basically just the first six episodes of the show, but with a few minor changes. And everybody's reaction was kind of like, what is the point of this? This just feels like a cash grab. This feels very cynical and unnecessary. And when I read that, I was like, I don't think I really want to see this. And then I lived under that assumption that that was what the rebuild films were and were going to be. I believed that until the last one came out in America 3 months ago. So like 14 years. I was thinking that that was the case. And every once in a while, I would see something. I'd see Asuka with an eye patch. And I'd be like, oh, Asuka has an eye patch. I never thought, I wonder what else is different. Just, like, do I have lead poisoning? What was I thinking? And so, the fourth film got announced. It was released in Japan in the spring of this year, and then it was announced that it would be released in America on Amazon Prime Video, and that they would also be putting the first three up to stream as well. And so, it was released, and I was like, well, they're all out now, it's done. I'm going to watch them, finally. You know, I've been ignoring them for 14 years, but I should watch them. So I watched the first one, and everybody was right. It was just the first six episodes of the show with a few little differences. Mostly there was a scene at the end of the movie that was very interesting where I was like, oh, And so then I watched the second one. And it was very clear to me almost immediately that something, I was wrong. I was very, 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 very wrong about what I thought these movies were. And when I figured that out, I got unbelievably scared and filled with shame. And I figured out that these movies, they aren't a remake of Evangelion. I don't know if it would be wrong to call them a sequel. But what they are is Anno grappling with this thing that he made, the thing that has given him probably the most joy and pain in his life. You know, it's given him fame and success and money and opportunity and pride and awards and all of that, but it's also just given him pain and trauma and madness and shame and guilt and pressure and all of these things. And you feel that really hard in the third movie. Third movie is called You Cannot Redo, which is a pretty bold title for something that's supposed to be a remake. And the way that the third movie feels, the third movie is less liked by people than the others, which makes sense because it feels almost like the entire movie is Anno giving a big middle finger to everybody who liked Evangelion. It is as though he has researched everything that the fans like, everything that the fans want, all of the ships and everything like that, and it's as though he has come and he has said, I'm giving you the opposite of everything that you wanted. I'm taking all of your dreams, I'm destroying them all. Everything that you never wanted to happen, now it has come true. And when he finished that movie in 2012, he didn't know if he could finish the series. There was still one movie left, but he was like, I have to stop. I can't do this anymore. And so it took 9 years to make the final Evangelion film. And in that time, he did a number of things. He directed Shin Godzilla, most notably, which was a very good movie. Then he finally came back, and they spent like a solid 6 years making the movie. And it ended up being 2 hours and 35 minutes long. It's one of the longest animated movies ever made. And it's unbelievable. It is like a miracle. It is him coming to this story that has caused him so much joy and so much pain for 25 years, you know, half of his life. He comes back to it, you know, all these years later, and he says, what if I can give Shinji something that I never got, which is a world without all of this bullshit. I'm being ambiguous on purpose, but there was a meme I saw from the Ava subreddit that was when it came out on, you know, on streaming. Of course, things go up on streaming like at midnight, so everybody was staying up all night to watch it. And this person made this meme that was, you know, them, it was a, like a comic of them sitting in their living room, and you know, the TV is displaying like the final scene of the movie. And then the other panel is them standing on the roof of an apartment building, you know, a couple floors up. And they're looking out over, like, a parking lot, some buildings, some trees. And they're drinking a hot cup of coffee, and they're watching the sun come up. And it was just called, this is, like, how it felt to watch Thrice Upon a Time, which is the final movie. And that really captured it in a way that I can't necessarily vocalize. I tried to kind of mirror that feeling with the video I made a little while ago. It was just kind of a dumb throwaway video that was like watching End of Evangelion when I was 16 versus watching Rebuild of Evangelion when I'm 31. And, It's interesting. Most Eva fans now, Eva's so big on the internet, and it's really become popular with young people. I'm old for an Eva fan, even though I wasn't even around when it first happened. And most people who are Eva fans have only seen it for the first time in the last couple of years, particularly once it went up on Netflix, because it was unavailable in, like, legal ways to acquire it for many, many years until it got put up on Netflix last year, which brought in a ton of new fans. But it's a lot of people, I think, have had not as good of a reaction to the rebuilds and see them as inferior. And I think that there is something to be said about the fact that they were made with all of that time and wizened growth from their creator removed from the original. And the same could be said about me watching them. You having grown 15 years worth of growing up between then and now, and the way I see it changing, really wild and powerful. So, you need to see the original before you watch these movies. I'm sorry. It's just, you just have to. You're not gonna get it if you don't. The original series and End of Evangelion movie are all streaming on Netflix. The new Netflix dub and translation, a lot of people have a lot of problems with it. I am here to tell you that their grievances are justified, but the severity of them is probably not. It is not terrible. It is not unacceptable. It's an acceptable dub and translation. You can watch it with the original audio and subtitles, but the new translation retains the language changes. There are a few that are a big sticking point for me, which the main ones are that the End of Evangelion movie has a couple of F-bombs in it in the original translation that have been taken out of the new translation because they want to be more accurate, and there's not actually like swear, there's no analogous word to fuck in Japanese. They don't have swear words like that, and so when people translate Japanese things, they'll use cursing to kind of like convey the tone of the original language. And so, I'm not going to give you any context, but they took a line, the original line being, I am so fucked up. Like, in the sense of, I am a fucked up individual. And they turned that into, I am the worst of the worst. And you don't need to be an expert in the English language to know that one of those sentences is conveying something much more strongly than the other one is. That's all I'll say about that. Watch those on Netflix, then you can watch the rebuilds on Prime. It's one of the best things ever made. The greatest world building, crazy lore and shit, just bonkers. It's confusing, but it's okay. Don't worry about it. I could talk about Ava forever. Number two and number one, like I said at the outset of this video, are functionally tied. I couldn't, in good conscience, truly choose one over the other. And so I left it to relevance. And so I have chosen the older film to go first and left the newer film at the top of the pile. And this film that's coming in second place, I have directly referenced earlier in this list. It is a feature-length compilation of three short films, the first of which was entitled Everything Will Be Okay, which was released in 2006. The second, I Am So Proud of You, which was released in 2008. The third and final of the trilogy also gave its name to the whole piece as it was assembled into a feature-length movie, and that is titled It Is Such a Beautiful Day.
Will was born late Tuesday morning into a world of orange and red. He'd read once how each cell in the body replaces itself and dies as the years pass, how everyone is slowly reconstructed out of continuously changing pieces, out of continuously changing pieces, a world of orange and red. That afternoon, she told him it was over.
She told him it was over.
Will looks out at the water and thinks of all the wonderful things he will do with his life.
All the wonderful things he will do with his life, she told him it was over.
Bill, can you hear me? Bill, can you look up here for me? Can you tell me what these objects are? Bill, can you tell me what this is?
Bell of Eternity,
Bill,
is actually taking
can you
place.
Add up these numbers for us?
Never vanishes away.
Doing great, Bill.
In the future,
I am
has already happened.
What do these numbers add up to?
Look at me, Bill. Look at me. Bill, look at me.
Okay, Bill, can you tell me who this is?
He's momentarily quiet.
Okay, Bill, you're doing great.
And then tell me, Bill, he doesn't have very long
Bill,
to live.
Can you tell me
he
who this is?
I am very in long pain. To live.
Do you remember her?
Bill, you come to know you hear me, just Bill?
Look at me, Bill. Look at me.
You will only get older. He began to think of people in a new light. How everyone's just little more than that frightened, fragile brain stem surrounded by meat and physics too terrified to recognize the sum of their parts. Everyone in the supermarket looks like some sort of demon. He doesn't have very long to live.
I am in pain.
And they all had gigantic bacteria-ridden crotches buried in all the goddamn produce. Desperately throwing dead bodies off the level boat. He doesn't have a very long experience to live. He doesn't have very long 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 to live.
He's not gonna die.
He doesn't die.
Bill, get up.
Get up.
Bill, get up.
He can't die.
He's not gonna die.
He doesn't die.
Bill.
It's such a beautiful day.
It's such a beautiful day. Chronicles a character named Bill. Bill's a, you know, young-ish guy, middle-aged guy. And there's something wrong with him. Neurologically. Hertzfeld has said that it is a specific thing. His condition is based on a specific medical condition, but he's not going to ever divulge what specifically it is because he doesn't want it to be like, you know, if he were to say this is about moose bumps, he doesn't want it to be the movie about having moose bumps, you know. He wants it to be more of a generalized experience than that. And so Bill he's having problems with his memory. He can't remember things. And he's going to the doctor to try and figure out what's wrong with him. And he's trying new medications, but none of them seem to be working. He starts taking new medications. He's hallucinating. He goes back to the hospital. They can't figure out what's wrong with him. And the movie just sort of like is this exploration of memory and illness and mental illness and reality and keeping your grip on it, as the cycles Bill explores the history of his family, the cycles that repeat throughout time, each generation. And the whole time he's losing himself. Slowly but surely, his mind is leaving him. And I will say that this movie is very funny at times. It's very silly. at times. I will also say that this movie is so devastatingly sad. One of the saddest things that I have ever seen. It's also completely terrifying. Truly, utterly horrifying. Because the things that terrify me, I'm not scared by monsters or aliens or the chupacabra, because, like, they're not real. Losing your mind is real. It really happens to people. It could happen to me. And it really scares me. And I've never seen a movie that is better at conveying that than this movie. I wish I could really tell you how I feel inside when I think about this movie. I'm at this point in my life where I've been doing therapy and stuff for long enough now that I'm finally kind of starting to wake up. For the first time in a really long time, I feel awake. I feel present. I feel alive in a way where before I felt very removed and detached. And I didn't really feel much of anything back then. And so now I'm feeling these feelings that are all so unfamiliar to me. And I don't know how to tell you what they feel like. They just feel really big. Like bigger than a bus, bigger than any of us, bigger than anything I could see with my eyes. And this movie makes me feel all of them, all at once, as hard as I can. And it's not good or bad. It's just a lot. But it is good because I'm so grateful that I feel anything at all. And that's why I love this movie. I hope you trust me. Don't go with your instincts that this is a movie with stick figures in it. That's what I did. I knew about this movie for a long time. It was on Netflix for forever, back when it first came out. And I never watched it. Even though it's a compilation of three short films, it's only barely an hour long. It's like 62 minutes long. And I just thought, you know, stick figures, an hour long, meh. There's no way it's that good. And I let myself think that for 10 years. It was real stupid. I wasn't really looking forward to doing this video because I knew it was going to be really heavy. I also knew that I needed to cut these the way that they were because I was going to have a lot to say once I got to the top here. Because this video is going to be probably about as long talking about 10 movies as the last one was talking about 20. So we're at the top, we're at number one. And it's a movie that released this year. And it won the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival. And I went to see it the day it came out in America, so I was so excited for it. And when I saw it the first time, I didn't know how I felt. I liked it a lot. I knew that. And I've talked about this movie before on this channel in my video I did on the top horror of the 21st century. I think I put it at like 5 on that list. So clearly I liked it a lot. But then I let it kind of marinate for a couple months. And then a couple days ago I watched it again. And I realized that when I saw it the first time, I recognized the way that I felt as similar to the way that people in the Bible feel when they're confronted with something divine, and it is so incomprehensible to them. Like the way that the biblical angel is described. And that was, I think that was how I felt when I watched Titane for the first time. Titane from 2021, directed by Julia Ducournau. So that trailer is kind of the classic foreign film trailer where they don't let any dialogue happen so that people don't realize that it's French. And they just play music over it and try to trick you. Which is funny because it's like the title is in French and the director's name is obviously French. And it references it being at the Cannes Film Festival, which is French. But it doesn't do a very good job of telling you what this movie is about. And I don't think I want to tell you what this movie is about very badly either. I do always think that going into something blind is the best way to see it, right? You're going to get the most out of it. I went into this close to blind. I read a one-sentence synopsis of this movie before I saw it. And so here are the choices I'm going to give you. you can leave now and know that I am telling you that this is top 10, top 5 things ever for me. Of the thousands of things that I've seen. Literal thousands of things that I've seen. You can take that and you can hold that and you can go and you can see it. Or we can talk about it a little bit. I'll talk about it a little bit and then I'll tell you I'm going to talk about it more. So if you just want a little bit, here's what I'll give you. The thing I knew about it going in was a sentence from IMDb that said, after having sex with a car, a woman finds herself inexplicably pregnant. Okay. The other incurrent on IMDb one sentence synopsis of this was the one that was floating around at Cannes before the movie first screened. People knew, you know, Julia Ducournau, this is her second film. She previously directed the film Raw, which is a very well-liked movie. And so they knew that she was debuting this new movie, but all anybody knew about it was the name and this one sentence that they had. And that sentence is, following a series of unexplained crimes, a father is reunited with the son, his son, who has been missing for over 10 years. So I'm gonna, now I've given you those two descriptions of this movie that on the surface do not seem to have anything to do with each other. And if that is enough to get you to watch this movie, I implore you to stop watching this video and go do so. If you need more, let's talk more. So this movie is about so many things. It is so dense with ideas. It is so packed full of themes. It's a body horror movie, maybe at its core, more than anything. Which makes sense. Ducournau, that seems like that's kind of her wheelhouse. To this point, it's early in her career, but that's, you know, what she's been doing so far. Very Cronenbergian body horror. Now, the thing about body horror, the reason why it works as well as it does, at least for me, is because it's about change, right? It's about changing. So it's a metaphor, right? In this movie, we have the change coming in a bunch of different directions, though. We've got the change of the body horror of the pregnancy, of this pregnancy. She's been impregnated by a car. And we have the change of just pregnancy in general. But there is this sort of more horrifying body horror element to it because of the car, is what I will say about that. Then we have change in gender, where the main character, Alexia, she assumes a different identity, and that is an identity of a boy, of a man, and she's forced to do things to pass, to perform this change of gender. And performance of gender is a huge theme in this movie. Very big, very important idea that this movie wants to talk about. The way that we perform gender. And the way we can change it. And then there is the change of the self, the inside, the soul. Maybe. And You know, I talked just a few minutes ago about this sort of long period of dormancy in my emotional life and how inaccessible intimacy was for me for so long, and feelings were, and all of that. And the outset of this film, in many ways, Alexia is the same. She cannot have human intimacy in her life. The only intimacy she seems to be able to have, the only thing that really seems to bring her any amount of passion, is cars and machines, steel, inhuman, cold things. And the closer she gets to humanity, to people, the more she rejects in varying ways. Until she meets the second lead of the film, a man by the name of Vincent. And so if I tell you that this is a horror movie, I'm not lying to you, but I am misleading you, maybe. Because what this movie is about love and about family and about allowing yourself to love and be loved by other people. And it's about a lot more than that too, but that's about all I've got after two viewings. This movie is unbelievable. I feel like I could watch this movie every day for the rest of my life. Because it gives me hope. It's about two really fucked up people who find each other and are able to get better. They're able to give each other what they need. And for a long time, the movies that I was really vibing with were very nihilistic. The music, too. Just everything in general, very nihilistic. Very hard and cold and unforgiving. Something like Melancholia or the music of Have a Nice Life. And that's not what I, it's not where I am anymore. You know? I need more hope than that right now. And that's what Titane has for me. Big ups to the Con Committee for giving this the big prize. It's the second time that a female director has ever won the Palm. Which is pretty crazy that. Anyways, but no chance that this is going to even get shortlisted for Best Foreign Film at the Oscars. It's too weird. It's too weird for the Academy, 100%. It's going to be Drive My Car. I haven't even seen it yet, and I know that that's what's going to win. But yeah. So that's everything. That's all the top 10. Tomorrow's New Year's Eve. I don't know if I'm going to get this out on New Year's Eve or not. I might not get this out until the 1st. But tomorrow night I'm going over to some friend's house. And I'm going to make them watch Love Exposure, which is one of my favorite movies. And that's going to be how we bring a close and call curtains on the year, is with Love Exposure. Which feels proper. Another hopeful movie about love. Thanks for watching my 4 hours of me talking about movies. When I say it like that, it doesn't sound very fun or cool. But I appreciate it. And I appreciate the comments that I've gotten on that tag I did talking about the end of the year. People talking about, you know, my diversifying of content and stuff. I'm glad that people were positive and receptive. So thank you. Thanks for watching. Thanks for sticking around. And the book video will be coming next, so keep your eyes peeled for that.